Good evening, everyone. All right, we'll try it again. Good evening, everyone. I know a lot of you guys are still kind of piling in and getting seated, but in the interest of time, as you're just kind of coming in, make your way to your seat. We got to go ahead and get started. We want to kick this thing off. I know I'm excited to dig in. Dan's excited. Chris is excited to dig in. So we're just going to go ahead and kick this off. Do me a favor, though, as you're getting seated, lean back in your seat and say, Jesus.
Jesus.
All right, so a lot of y'all didn't know that was coming. I understand. So we're going to try that again. I want to fill this room with testosterone, some Christ-like testosterone. Yes, sir. Where you at, man? Represent. He just came in with it. That's what I'm talking about. Let's try it again. Lean back in your seat and say, Jesus.
Jesus.
Say, Jesus.
Jesus.
That's what I'm talking about. Did you guys feel that? That was some real testosterone right there. Well, we're going to go ahead and get started. Hopefully you go ahead and make your way to your seat. Just want to lay out some preliminaries. We do want to have some Q&A. So you're getting some index cards as you're coming in. Hopefully you've gotten those. We hope to get to some questions. We hope to answer as many as we possibly can with the time restraints that we're working with. During the last presentation over this course of 50 minutes or so, you're going to see a receptacle come around. Our faithful volunteers will pass around a receptacle. You can place your question in that receptacle. They'll bring those questions to us. Here's what I want to make sure you understand. Obviously, we cannot get to everyone's question, but what you can do, and I want you to take note of this, write down this email address, men's ministry, that's all one word, men's ministry at calvaryftl.org. You can email your question in, and we will be purposeful, myself and those that are partnering with us here, Chris, Daniel, we'll all make sure that we'll get to your questions throughout the week, possibly give a halfway decent answer to those questions. So make sure you go ahead and do that. Men's ministry at Calvary FTL. You can email those questions in. But without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and kick things off here. And I'd like to introduce myself. I can't assume that all of you know me. My name is Darren. I have the privilege of overseeing our 678 middle school ministry here at Calvary Chapel, Fort Lauderdale. So if you have any middle schoolers, I know some of you all may have children. You may be widowed or possibly divorced and you just have a middle schooler. I get the privilege to speak into their lives. So thank you for entrusting me with your prized possession. It's a blessing to be able to do that. I'm going to give about a 10-minute talk here, and then we'll pass the baton over to Chris. Chris is going to share, and then Daniel will share as well. But here's the deal. Everything that you hear over the course of my 10 minutes will principally be centered around this one line. This one line will be the very central thought of everything that I say, and it's simply this, and you can write it down if you want. Rise and grind. The struggle is real. Somebody turn to, here's the Pentecostal side of me. Turn to your neighbor and say, rise and grind. The struggle is real. Rise and grind, the struggle is real. Again, that's everything you'll hear over the course of the next 10 minutes of my talk will be embodied by that line. And if I was to break my talk down into two central points, it'd be simply this. A life resisting God and a life redeemed by God. That's my story. And I come to you simply as an individual who really should not be here. Wasn't cut from the covenant cloth of a family that kind of raised up a pastor. No, I was cut from a different cloth. As I share, you'll see there's a lot of relatability here. My goal is not to be very scripturally heavy, but to be very relational and practical, to get right down into the trenches with you all. And so I'm going to pray very quickly, and then we'll dive into the next 8 minutes of my time. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity to speak into the lives of each one of these single men that are here today, Lord, that have taken the time out of their schedules to be challenged. God, that's an accomplishment in and of itself. They could have stayed home. They could have said, you know what, men's conference, don't need it. I'll save it. But they're here. And so that's a major step in the right direction, and we celebrate that, God. And so, God, speak through each one of us, this panel, the wealth of information that is disseminated, that goes out, Lord, I pray that it would penetrate their hearts, that they would be receptive as they navigate this journey of singleness regarding sex and intimacy. Lord, we love you. Let this time be blessed by you. It's in Jesus' name. And everyone said. Amen. It was about 1990 when I was faced with a very precarious situation. It was a situation that wasn't designed by God. It wasn't the God-ordained thing, but it was a thing, and it happened to me. I was faced with a broken family. I come from a large family that had about 6 or 7 people around the dinner table, and it was a good dynamic, a blended family, but nonetheless a great family. And all of a sudden, I looked up, and I was faced with the divorce of my mom and dad. I was moved from Stamford, Connecticut, down to Florida into a situation that presented racism for the very first time as a biracial kid. But not only did I battle through that, you see, my mom decided as a single woman and out of loneliness and desperation to take in a Caucasian, Anglo-American who happened to have racism in his heart. And he's living with now 2 biracial kids, but he's also an alcoholic. And so we were exposed to things that no 8- and 9-year-old should have been exposed to, my brother and I. We were exposed to the verbal abuse of a drunk man who would ring into my mother and say things to her that I probably shouldn't have heard. But the reality is, my mom, out of loneliness and desperation, utilized me because he just so happened to like me. I was the lighter of the two. And she would utilize me as that damage control. Darren, tell him don't leave. He would threaten to leave. He knew my mom was desperate and lonely, and so he used that as leverage to get what he wanted, to manipulate. And he'd walk out of the house, and as an 8-, 9-, or 10-year-old, I would have to chase behind him at the beckoning of my mother, begging him not to leave. It made me angry. Made me mad. And then I was inflicted by pornography. And I realized, hey, this filled a void because I was now very angry. And as I began to navigate into my teenage years as an angry kid coming from a broken home, experiencing brokenness, that void was at least unauthentically being filled. And porn would lead to chasing sexual encounters. So now I'm an angry, broken teen that's addicted to pornography, and now I'm addicted to sex because I'm searching. I'm broken. I'm angry. So my life, believe it or not, from 16 to 26, was consumed by sex, pornography, and violence. I got into gangs because that's where I felt love. That's where I was drawn to. I was drawn in, but it really wasn't until I had a very, very real encounter with God. After having broken relationships, after having relationships broken, after having gone through a divorce, yes, I walked through that. Not a perfect man, but I am a redeemed man. You see, my life, yeah, it was spent pushing God away. I don't want this God, this Jesus that you're talking about. I'm angry. I'm violent. I want sex and I want pornography. I want to get my fix. But God made himself very real to me in a moment of depression. It wasn't until I was at my wit's end that I encountered him, that he showed up when I really, really needed him the most. And that would lead to discipleship and accountability. And I would be put on a path of redemption and restoration. Now, I'd be lying to you at the age of 35 now if I was to sit here and tell you that I don't wrestle with temptation still. As a married man, now with 5 kids, a beautiful wife, she's bad, y'all, bad. But I would be lying to you if I said I didn't wrestle with the urge and the pull to go back to that pornography. You see, oh, my phone is blocked. I've got all the software. You see, my laptop, it's all blocked off. But there's moments where I'm jonesing. I'm shaking. I'm like, man, I would love to get a quick fix. Because the reality is, the struggle's real. And so as a redeemed man, I wake up every morning and I make a conscious decision. You want to know what that is? Here it is. I could either allow Satan to give me a headache, or I can venture to give him a headache. You can write that one down. Matter of fact, tweet that out and tag me on it. I'm just joking. But I could either allow Satan to give me a headache, or I could say, you know what, I'm gonna give him a headache. You see, we could either, check this out, we could either rest in temptation, in other words, just allow it to take over us. We looked at David's life, and when David should have been out in war, he was what? He was resting, hanging, just chilling on the balcony. We could rest in temptation, or we can wrestle when in temptation. You've got to make a choice. Either you rest in it and give up and wallow in it and say, I can't take it. Satan, though, he's attacking me. I'm not making light of your struggle because it's real, but you got to grind it out. You've got to make a cognitive decision, and I'll put it to you this way. You've got to go to war. In the same way David should have went to war, you've got to make up in your mind, I'm going to war. Let me make it very real to you. We're in football season, football fans. All right, we'll use Eli Manning because I'm a New York Giants fan, and the reality is you can't spell elite without the E-L-I. I'm just saying. Sorry, Dolphin fans. But Eli does not go out on the football field knowing that he's going to get hit without his pads. You see, how do you parallel that with us? When you get up in the morning, you've got to understand that temptation is going to come. It's Satan's job, and he's good at it. He's going to hit you. One thing I realized that Eli was good at, though, he may throw an interception and fall one round or one series. He's real good at getting amnesia because he'll go out there and find Odell Beckham for a 45-yard bomb and score. What am I saying? Yeah, you're going to get hit. Yeah, you're going to fall down, but you don't stay down. You get up. There's a difference between a life living in habitual sin or a life that would say, you know what? A sinful moment doesn't define me. Yeah, we'll fall. Yeah, we'll make mistakes. Yes, we will be tempted. Go to your brother. Go to the Father first. Confess. Seek your accountability. An acronym for war, and I'm going to sit down and pass the baton to Chris. It's the word. The W, it's the word. Fill yourself with God's word every single day. You wake up and allow God to engulf you in his word. And then the A in war. Make sure you have that battle buddy. Make sure you have that accountability. Make sure you have the software. And the R, make sure that you resist Satan. He's coming, and you're going to get hit, and you will fall. Again, I'm not a perfect man. There's been moments where I've had to confess to a brother, like even now as a youth pastor, man, listen, I felt tempted, I fell. And the pastor that I had confessed to looked me in the eyes and told me what I just told you. One moment of failure doesn't define your lifestyle. The hits will come. You pad yourself up. Get amnesia. Say, you know, I'm not going to let this define me. And I'm going to keep tracking ahead. I'm going to keep living this life in Christ, moving in his direction. The reality is this, though. All the software in the world doesn't necessarily get the job done. Pastor Chris is going to share with you the source that we really need to get that job done. Chris.
Amen. Thank you, Darren. Hey, you give him a hand. So you know, as Darren just said, that the struggle you know is real. And I share a very similar testimony to that of Darren. And I think of when I gave my life to the Lord and the things that he kind of took away from me immediately, there was those, well, it was the foul words that would come out of my mouth. It was the addiction to certain drugs. But that one thing that for some reason, God did decide to leave that struggle in my life, it is the struggle of the eyes and lust. And so you know that that struggle is real. You know that it's something that you face every single day. Know this, though, that being tempted is not the sin. We're all tempted. Jesus was tempted in the desert. The sin comes when we fall and when we fail. And sometimes, well, as Darren was mentioning, we let it kind of become the pattern. And we, for a season, find ourselves in a struggle and in bondage, and we don't know what to do. And here's the really cool thing about today at this men's conference on sex and intimacy. You're going to hear some really good, practical things. You're going to get a piece of paper, and it's going to talk to you about software to possibly put on your phone that would prevent you from looking at certain websites and searching certain things. You could get accountability software on your phone or your computer so that when you fall, as we all do because we're human, Well, it's attached to someone else, and it's an accountability partner, and they know, and they call, and they say, man, I got this report. What's going on? I saw you search for this. How? Let's pray. Let's draw close to God. And you're going to hear these things today, and they're good. They're good things. Proverbs 22 says that a prudent man foresees evil and hides himself, but a simple man, a dumb man, he sees it, and he walks right into it, and he's punished for it. I pray for prudence for us, that we would be able to look at our lives and see weakness and hide ourselves from it. And whether that's an accountability partner, whether that's some kind of software on your phone or your computer, you would take those steps of being radical about your sin. But know this, if that's what you're depending on, you're setting yourself up for failure. And it was a couple of years ago, and I don't know if you're new to our church, but we went through a very difficult time as a church. And it caused me to even search my soul and look at my life and think, well, if that can happen to him, can it happen to me? And I began to pray, and God took me to the book of 1 John, and I've preached this before at our campus in Plantation, and I just got to give you like the concise version here, the concentrate. But in 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, listen to what John says. This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. John says, listen, I got to tell you something about God. He's light, and in him is no darkness at all. And the person that says that they have fellowship with him and walk in a pattern of darkness in their life, they're lying to you. They're not telling you the truth. It's impossible. It's kind of like saying, you know, a Patriot fan is a good person. It's impossible. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I like the Giants, so I'm good. But I just want you to consider the truth of what John says there. The flip side of it. He says that if you're saying that you have fellowship with God, but you're walking in a pattern of darkness and sin, and it has become that thing that is defining your life, you're lying. And it's that word fellowship I want you to consider. It's not relationship. John is not calling into question, and I'm not calling into question anyone's relationship with God. That is a blood-bought thing by Jesus Christ. He paid for our sins. It's by his blood that we are accepted and loved. And no matter what you've done today, this week, this month, or this year, he loves you and he looks at you as perfect because of what Christ has done. Not because of you. Not because of how you've fallen or where you find yourself in sin. He will always love you the same. The word that he uses is fellowship. Fellowship speaks of proximity, closeness, and I love what we just heard in there from Frank about David's distance from God and his sin. And when he should have been out in the battlefield with the presence of God, he found himself separated and on a roof, and he fell. And so the flip side of this verse, that if you have fellowship with God, it is impossible to walk in darkness. Oh, that you would just grasp onto that and let it sink into your heart right now. That if you have fellowship with God, consistent, close relationship, intimacy with him, there will never be a time in your life when you will walk in darkness. Now, you will fall, you will sin. The next few verses down say, listen, if anyone says they don't have sin, they're a liar. And the truth is not in him. And we have this amazing promise that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive and cleanse. But he says, if you're pressing in, if you're rising and grinding, if you're in the word, if you're drawing near, if you are abiding in Christ, well, here's what'll happen. You'll get in the word and you'll pray, and maybe you're struggling with your phone or the computer, and not a condemnation, but a conviction will fall. And grace will begin to cover you. And you'll hear the words of Jesus say, I love you, and I've got something better for you, and I've got strength for you, and I can break these chains. Stay close to me. Because here's what we're all really in need of. It's self-control, right? It's self-control of our eyes. when that woman walks by, when we're at Publix in the checkout stand, and there's those magazines, and it catches the side of our, and we know we shouldn't look, but then we do. And you're online, or you're looking up something on YouTube, you're looking up a sermon on YouTube, and then there's this side row of videos, right? And there's a girl, and she's not wearing much, and you know you should, but the self-control, and you lose it, and you click it. We're in need of self-control. And you know what the Bible says that we get self-control from? Not from software. Not from accountability. They're all good. The Bible says we get self-control from the Holy Spirit. It's a fruit. And how is fruit produced? And Jesus says in John 15, you abide in me. You remain in me. And I don't mean just waking up in the morning and reading a proverb and going, abiding, remaining. Every hour on the hour, you just draw near to the Lord. You're at your desk at work. You're in the car. God, just fill me afresh. Lord, I just messed up over there. I stared a little bit too long. Would you give me fresh grace? Would you strengthen me? And he promises this fruit of self-control is going to begin to grow in you. But men, it comes from abiding, remaining. Timothy Keller, he's an author and a pastor I love. And we just came from a place where every pastor quoted him. I'm going to quote him. He wrote a book on prayer, and he said this. Can you imagine if you went to the doctor and he told you, listen, you're going to die unless you take this pill every single day at this time. Do you think you'd ever come to a day when you'd be like, you know what, I'm really tired. I don't think I'm going to take the pill right now. I know the game's on. I think I'm going to skip the pill today. No, because your life depended on it. Men, your victory, your freedom, the fruit of self-control in this battle, it is dependent upon you abiding in Christ, remaining with him, drawing near to him. The only way that you will ever achieve purity in your singleness is intimacy with God. Know that and let it sink into your heart. And there is that place for software and accountability. If you look back at 1 John, he says this, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, then we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Don't flip-flop it. Don't think that you're, okay, I'm gonna get that app, I'm gonna get an accountability partner, but you forsake intimacy with Christ. It's very easy to lie to an accountability partner. How you doing this week? Oh, awesome, bro. Awesome. Been in the word, blessed and highly favored, bro. And really, 2 hours ago, you were in your car, on your phone, on a site you shouldn't have been on. It's easy to lie to one another when this is off. You need fellowship and intimacy with God before you can even think of having accountability with someone else. And you're the only one that can do that for yourself. And here's what I'll say probably in almost all my sermons, and if you're a plantation, you know this, I'm big into the tasting and seeing experience with God. It's great to come on a Friday night and hear men talk and teach about intimacy with God, but until you taste and see it for yourself, that's all it'll ever be. And people at my campus, they know I love steak. I don't have to have anyone tell me to eat steak. If it's sitting in front of me, I'm gonna eat it. You know why? Because I've tasted it for myself. I don't live off of someone else's experience. And so I just want to encourage, I want to challenge, man, that you would love the Lord Jesus and you would treasure him and you would rise and grind and you would be in the word and you would be in prayer every day, that knowing that when you have fellowship with him, there will not be a time when you will be walking in darkness. It's a promise of God. He is faithful. You know where the problem comes in? It's with us when we are faithless. Oh, I'm tired. I got so much going on, I can't pray. And listen, there's days when I know you don't have the hour to sit in your room on your knees and praying, but man, we have access at any time. You got the Bible on your phone. How many of you guys do fantasy football? Anyone do fantasy? Huh? You stare at your phone for an hour, changing your lineup. You can get in the word for a little bit on your phone, okay? And so again, I'm not here to condemn you. Guys, I love you. And I want you to walk in freedom. And I know the struggle of trying to prop up yourself sometimes with things and having a season of victory and then falling on your face and then it's like, what's wrong? What's the deal? It's fellowship. It's closeness. It's intimacy with Jesus. And I'll say it again, before you will ever achieve purity in your singleness, you will need intimacy with Jesus every day. And when you do that, it will be impossible. It's impossible, the Bible says, to walk in darkness. Guys, here's what we're gonna do now. We have actually have a special guest that's coming, Dr. Rob Otto. And part of this struggle of purity is pornography. And he's got some really amazing facts on the effects of pornography, not only on our brain, but on the relationships that we have in our lives. So if you guys wanna give him your attention.
Wow, this is great. I love talking about sex in the church. I just made a bunch of guys blush in the other auditorium. That's pretty fun. All right. Listen, I'm gonna talk to you about brain chemistry. How God wired you, what happens when you use it the way he plans, and what happens when it gets out of kilter and you start using that other way. So four chemicals real quick. The first one's testosterone. It's known as a manly hormone. Listen, this is what makes us men. This is what gives you that sense of, I'm a man, I feel like a man, I talk like a man, muscles grow, your hair grows in your chest, and your attitude beefs up. During sex, during intercourse, it's responsible for an erection. Yeah, we can say that in church. Somebody told me on the way over here, you had my attention at that point on, okay? Listen, it's also responsible for a rapid heartbeat. It's responsible for, it's linked to that accelerated heartbeat and the sense of, wow, it's a rush, you know? And that all comes from testosterone, all right? God planned it that way. He made you that way, and he put that all through your body. It's pretty cool. Number two, dopamine. It's a pleasure drug. Notice up there, it's pretty simple looking, right? That's because it doesn't take much to please us, okay? All right, now listen, dopamine is a pleasure drug. It peaks at orgasm. We can say that word in church too, all right? It peaks at orgasm. And it's responsible for that rush, that intense rush of, oh, that felt great. It's what keeps you coming back for more, okay? Now, the next one I want to tell you about is vasopressin. And vasopressin, think of this as a monogamy molecule. And vasopressin is like super glue in your brain. You just had that big dopamine rush. Oh, that felt great. I want more of that. Vasopressin says, this is where you come to get more. Okay, so when you're married someday and you have sex with your wife, your brain programs to come back to her over and over and over and over again. Now, vasopressin, all these chemicals, their value is neutral. What that means is that this will bond you to your wife. It'll bond you to pornography. It'll bond you to another woman. It'll bond you to a man. It'll bond you to anything that you get sexual satisfaction from. It doesn't just bond you to things that are godly. So this is values neutral. Now, with regard to vasopressin also, there's a flip side to this. Anything that comes between you and what you're bonded to becomes the enemy. So if you're in a relationship and your friends look on, or your family look on, and say, hey, that's toxic. You need to cool that off. Well, you're gonna look at them and you're gonna say, you're the enemy. This is good. Don't you know how good that feels? Because you've wired your brain to be super glued to this. Now, similarly, when you get married, somebody tries to harm your wife, what are you going to do? You're going to rip his head off, okay? Thank you, vasopressin. I have bonded to my wife, and anything that tries to harm her is my enemy. So, also, you ever try to confront a friend who's dealing with pornography? You might experience his wrath. You might experience his wrath. All right, the next one's oxytocin. Oxytocin is a snuggle drug. Think of this as the women's equivalent of vasopressin. It's like super glue in their brain. And it bonds a mom to a baby when she nurses. It bonds a wife to a husband or a man to a woman when there's sexual intercourse. And again, it's values neutral. So it'll bond her to her husband. It'll bond her to anybody else, male or female, who satisfies her, who releases this chemical. Now, here's how powerful this chemical is for a woman. A 20-second hug for a girl releases enough oxytocin in her brain that even though she knows that guy's not trustworthy, her brain screams out, oh, but he's the one, and I think I can trust him. You ever wonder why girls don't leave guys who are idiots? Hey, I'm serious. Listen, it is brain chemistry. It's a chemical called oxytocin that God made and put in their brains to bond to their husbands. But it'll bond them to something else that's toxic also. Here's my question for you, guys. Do you think that if you bond to something over and over and over again, that that's going to make it easy for you to bond to your wife someday? What are you doing in your relationships now? You know, hugging and kissing doesn't just feel good when you get married. It's not like there's a switch that flips, oh, married now, that feels good. You know, it feels good now. Why? Because God put testosterone all through us, right? But your wife's not going to want you to super glue your brain to anything when you're married other than her. Don't do it now and start a pattern that you'll regret down the road. Let's talk about a couple emotions here. First off is joy and pleasure. Hey, God created sex. It's his idea. We can even talk about it in church. We don't have to blush. We can use words like erection, like I did earlier, like orgasm. It's okay. Those are God's ideas. It's not like he's up there going, oh my gosh, what are they doing? You know, it's his idea, okay? He created us like that. Now, outside of the context of marriage, we experience guilt. We experience shame. You ever been stuck? Perhaps you're stuck now, and you've tried to stop looking at porn. You've tried to stop sleeping with your girlfriend. You've tried over and over and over again, and you keep falling back into that same, man. After a while, that guilt. Oh, yeah, Christian, you prayed about it too, right? God didn't answer that prayer yet. How does that make you feel as a Christian? You know? That guilt of I did bad changes pretty quickly to shame. Maybe I am bad. Maybe that's the reason that God hasn't answered my prayer and taken this thing away from me that's been hard for me. Maybe I'm the only one that his grace isn't big enough for. I'll tell you, that's a lie from the pit of hell. That's a lie from the pit of hell. When we're stuck in a rut, we're isolated, we're alone. And as Christians, what do? Oh, we put a mask on. How are you? I'm fine. I'm fouled up, insecure, neurotic, and exhausted. But I'm fine. Yeah, yeah. How's your week? You know, deflect, right? Wearing a mask is very, very tiring. It's good to take that mask off. It is. Let me give you some research here. 2016 research by the Barna Group. 84% of you. That's like from here over. Okay, 84% of you come across pornography regularly in your life. Let's just say every other month, every month, once a week, something like that. You come across it, you're not seeking it. That's a factor of living in America in 2016. All right, and there's things we can do to reduce that. 56% of you, that's like from here over. Seek it out regularly. You deliberately get on Netflix, YouTube, the dark web, Google, and you seek it. And most of you hate that about yourselves, if that's where you're stuck. Millennials. 56% of millennials think that not recycling, is a moral issue. 32% of you think that looking at pornography is a moral issue. That says a lot about our culture, doesn't it? We've been trained to think that pornography is no big deal. Well, how big a deal is it? What if you travel down that road? What if you use these brain chemicals that God created for you and you use them to bond to pornography instead of holding off and saying, God, I'll trust you on this and help me to do it differently? Well, in 2004, there was a survey done in Europe. 5.8% of men in this survey were dealing with erectile dysfunction. Okay? They couldn't perform sexually with a woman. 2 years later, 2006, 5.8% jumped to 30%. What happened in those 2 years? That was a shift from dial-up connections where it'd take you 45 seconds to get one low-res thumbnail-sized picture up to broadband streaming video. Pornography exploded, and the result was erectile dysfunction exploded too. 2014, 2 years ago, how many of y'all are in your 20s? Raise your hands. Okay. You guys, average age 25 years old, 58% were dealing with erectile dysfunction. 58%. Now, hang on. That's with women. But with pornography and masturbation, they're okay. What does that say about the power of these chemicals in our brains? God created them there so you would bond to your wife. Imagine how strong that bond will be to your wife someday. But if today you program your brain to think that this is what I need to pleasure me, then you're not going to be able to bond to your wife. And how's that honeymoon going to be for you? Knight in shining armor. How are you going to feel? I mean, really, how are you going to feel, guys? Nothing happens. and she's hot and nothing happens. How's your wife going to feel? Maybe like she's not pretty? I work at a counseling center. I have people come in my office all the time dealing with that issue 6, 8, 10 years into their marriage. And they've been trying it on their own to fix it, and the pain has grown, and they've got a big Grand Canyon between them. Canada, 2014, 50% of adolescents are dealing with erectile dysfunction, other sexual issues, and the psychological issues of depression that go along with it. United States Navy, 2016. Now, I'm an Army guy, so I can say this. 18 to 40-year-olds. Okay, these are like prime, let's have kids in our family kind of years. 18 to 40-year-olds, 30% dealing with erectile dysfunction. 30%. That's not God's plan. That's not what he wants, all right? So let me give you the solution. Here's the solution. First of all, make a decision. What are you going to bind your, superglue your brain to? I challenge you. If you wait to give all your hugs and kisses to your wife, that's countercultural, okay? But if you save every single hug and kiss you have from here on out for your wife, she will never, never regret that decision, and neither will you. She will thank you for it for the rest of your marriage. And that's a pretty cool thing. Start now. Just start now. But you can't just start now because you know that trying harder doesn't work, right? Trying harder doesn't work. All right, so what do you do? Tonight, before you leave, grab a buddy and say, I need to get together with you and talk about this week. Let's just get together and talk about it. And here's what I want you to ask him. Friday night, what did you think of those guys and what they said? What did you relate to? Okay, see where the conversation goes. And he can ask you the same question. Then I want you to go home. I want you to go to YouTube and write this down in your notepads there. Ted Roberts. Ted Roberts. T-E-D-R-O-B-E-R-T-S. Ted Roberts. If you plug that into YouTube on the little search, you'll see probably the top one is a guy who's like Vietnam age. He was a fighter pilot in Vietnam. Tells you his age. And he has a black button-down shirt, long sleeve. Watch the video. And then get back together with your buddy and talk about it. Say, hey, what did you relate to from Ted? And I tell you, he works with pastors on this issue for like 34 years. He's awesome. He's a man's man, okay? And you'll laugh hysterically and you'll go, ooh, got me. All right. Talk about it with your buddy. See, because isolation, shame, hiding, wearing a mask, it loses its power when you start talking with a friend. Number two, a lot of you would benefit from getting together with a small group of guys. On this campus, before work, once a week, there's a group that meets. A dozen, 15, 20 guys, they meet. I have groups like that all over Broward and Palm Beach County. And it'd be life-changing for some of you to connect with that kind of a group regularly and talk with other guys who want to walk this way and who have struggled and stumbled and fallen and gotten back up and say, hey, let's do this together because I can do it better with another buddy. If you need help connecting with a group like that, hey, we can help you with that. We can help you with that. Now, I work at Spanish River Counseling Center up in Boca. Some of you might need to come and talk with me and chat with me. That might help you. I work on this issue every single day, every single day. And every guy that I talk to about this, he understands shame. He understands that feeling of, I did bad, maybe God's grace isn't big enough for me, and maybe that's the why I keep failing. And let me tell you, that's just not true. That is not true. There's no shame in asking for help. I learned as an Army Ranger, when you assess an enemy and you say, that guy's bigger than I can handle by myself, what do you do? You bring every asset to bear on that enemy. And that's called wisdom. That's called a wise warrior. Bring your buddy into this fight with you. Don't hide it and try it on your own. You're not bad for struggling in this area. You're a man who lives in a sinful world, in a sex-crazed world. And we have to fight this battle every day of our lives. Let me go back to the close of the story that Frank started back there. Psalm 51. That's where David is writing after Nathan confronts him, and he's broken. You're familiar with this. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I'll be clean. Wash me, and I'll be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness, and let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out my iniquity. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of my salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Guys, in the American church, we stop reading right there. But that's not where the story stops. Listen to the next verse. You might feel like you've been buried by this gorilla. And you might have made a lot of mistakes. But listen to this next verse. Then, after repentance, then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will turn back to you. God is not done with you yet. And his grace is big enough to touch you on this particular area, right here deep in your heart and right here in your mind. Jesus said, come and follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. I guarantee when you walk through this journey as a man today in 2016, you'll be one of the few guys out there who can get a fishing pole and pull other guys into the boat. And the gospel of Jesus Christ will spread because of men like you who today say, God, help me take these steps now because I want to head down that road and not the other road anymore. All right? God bless you all. It's good to be here with you.
All right, how we doing? I know it's been about 2 hours now where you've been sitting down, you've been listening to people, some amazing speeches, some amazing information, some amazing teaching. But I just wanted to make sure that everybody's good. We're almost done. So let me get one more time. How you guys doing? All right. All right. So for me, my story is... you know, I was actually, praise God, I never actually struggled with pornography. I was showed it. I've been shown pornography before, and, you know, from friends here and there, but I would always just be like, whoa, no, not about that. But see, masturbation was something different for me. There was definitely a season, there was a time in my life where that was a struggle. And I remember I came to this place of just realizing that I didn't want to do it anymore. And I got together with a friend. I was like, bro, we need to kick this man. Come on. And we did one of those programs. I think it was called like Covenant Eyes or something. I forget what it was called. But it was one of those things where you keep each other accountable. You put your email in and they kind of see what your history has been. They can, you know, all these different things. And there's verses you go through. And so we did that. And, you know... I started to really walk in victory at that point in my life when it came to that struggle of masturbation. And all the way through that time, when the temptation would come, I remember it was hard. I remember it was hard. But I had to remember a verse. It was, he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And whenever I would get tempted, I would just have to say that. I would just repeat it over and over until the temptation went away. And so I had to seek the Lord. And through that time, there were definitely moments where I fell. But thank God, even to this day, it's been some time. And I give him the glory for that. And now that I am in a relationship with a wonderful girl, those standards are still the same. Those things are still things that I have to do. And even more standards have to be put in place because it's even harder because I will reiterate what has been said is that the struggle is real. I understand the struggle. See, the thing is, I want to just leave you with this. I want to leave you with a word from the Lord, with what his word says, because, I mean, anything that I say, yeah, it's good, but what the Lord says is better. And so I'm going to... go to Galatians, and it's found in chapter 5, verse 16. It's Paul speaking to the church of Galatians and churches of Galatia, and he is saying this to them. He says, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. Because what was happening at this time is the church, they were walking in the flesh. There was people coming in saying, hey guys, you gotta go back to the law. You gotta go back to circumcision. You have to get back to working in your flesh, submitting to your flesh. And people were buying it, they were believing it. And so Paul is rebuking them. He's saying, guys, you know, whoever's doing that, I wish that they would just cut themselves off. But he said, for you. And he's talking to the church, he's saying, guys, but remember, you gotta walk in the Spirit. He's getting them back to where they need to go. He's not saying you need to strive, you need to work, you need to try and cut this thing on your own. He's saying you need to walk in the Spirit. Do what was already done. Walk in what has been already done. And so we ask ourselves this question, well, how do you walk in the Spirit? Well, in Romans chapter 6, it says that we have to reckon ourselves dead to sin and alive with Christ. See, the first thing is realizing and reckoning that it's not you, it's the Lord. He already did it. See, the battle has been fought, the war has been won through what Jesus has done on the cross, and we can walk and we can reckon ourselves saying, you know what? It's already been done. And we have to realize that it's not our battle. It's the Lord. It's all that he's done. And so I want to leave you with a few words when it comes to kind of the practical, and realize that you've been delivered. Realize that you've been delivered. It's already happened. Sometimes, you know, I was thinking about it coming in here. I'm thinking of the things I wanted to kind of leave with you guys and some of the things that I've learned over the years. And I thought about, man, okay, it's desire, it's devotion that leads to deliverance. But I was like, no, I'm going to add deliverance in the beginning because it's already been done. And we have to reckon that. Our mind needs to start there. And I think once we realize that it has already been done, then the desire comes. See, it's just like people have gone before you to fight battles, to win wars for this nation, the USA, United States of America. And you were born into this nation, and you're free because they fought for you before you were even born. And see, what do? We honor the troops that we have. We honor the men and the women that have gone before us to fight. But there's one who has gone before us who's already fought our battles, already has won the war, and his name is Jesus. And he's the one that we're supposed to look to and honor and praise. And so being that we've been delivered, we now walk into something that's already been done, the question we have to ask ourselves is, do we desire to be delivered? Because again, the struggle is real. And even in moments in my own life, I've been, God, this is too hard. I can't do this. I sometimes don't even want to do this if we're gonna be real. I just give up, it's too hard. I've thought that sometimes. But in the end, I'm like, but not my will, yours be done. I want that. I desire to walk uprightly with the Lord. Do you? Ask yourself that question. Because without the desire, there's not going to be any devotion. And that's the thing that comes from desires. Once you desire to change, once you desire to walk uprightly, the devotion comes. It's seeking the Lord. It's what Pastor Chris was saying. It was just what all these men have been saying, is that it's really simple. It's just seek the Lord. Be in the Word. Be in prayer. It's not really focusing necessarily first on putting the applications on your phone and doing the practical steps. It's saying, no, I'm going to look to the one who can actually save me from this and who's actually delivered me from this already. Let me seek him and then take those practical steps. Make sure the focus is right. And then lastly, once the devotion comes, once the devotion is there and once we're seeking the Lord with everything that we've got, I really believe that deliverance that we see in this word of, we call the word of God, it comes. I think the deliverance that we all want, is it exists. And so I want to leave us with these thoughts and this question is simply this. Are you walking it? Because it's already been done. You've been delivered. Do you desire it? And if you desire it, are you being devoted to it, to the Lord? And I promise you, deliverance will come according to this word. So let's walk in it. Amen?
Amen. 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 Thanks, Dan. So guys, we got to get ready to head back over. But as I'm hearing all this, I my heart is that you don't get overwhelmed, but like, okay, I need to do this and this and this and this and this and this. I love that God makes it simple, but it's not easy. It's not very confusing. There's not 40 different things to do, and I just want to remind you of some of these things. Take your sin seriously and get an accountability partner and put software and do all those things and take those steps. But I think that one thing that we all have kind of had that common denominator. In the book of Titus says it's the grace of God that teaches you to live soberly, righteously, and godly. And I think sometimes we really don't grasp the goodness of the gospel. And some of you are living in shame. There's no way. I shouldn't even go to this men's conference. The things I've done, I did it today. I looked at porn today. I looked at porn a couple hours. He loves you just the way that you are. And the blood of Jesus has covered you. And just pursue to know that in a deeper way. Yes, be drastic. Cut your hand off if need be. And you know, don't go around cutting your hand off. Be drastic. But just seek to know how much he loves you. It's that love and that goodness that's going to lead you to repentance. So guys, we love you. It was an honor just to share from our different perspectives what God has done in our life. Let us pray for you. We're going to go back. Pastor Doug's going to close us out afterwards, and he'll mention this. They're going to invite us out on the green for a time of fellowship. We're going to be out there. If you're like, man, I need some prayer, I'd love to hear a little bit more about your story. Tell me a little bit more about that. We're going to be out there for that. But Darren, would you close us in prayer?
Sure.
They told us to end at 9:10. Yeah, it's 9:11. Did you want to say something?
I thought we had
till
9:20.
Yeah. Oh, we can. Okay.
10 minutes for Q&A.
Okay. Cards? In the bucket.
Cards in the bucket.
Where's the bucket? They're going around now.
Oh, they're going around now. Were any cards looked at it at all yet? You got one?
Mike's got some cards. All Pastor right, Mike, some. Thank you.
Let's give Pastor Mike a hand, y'all.
Let me.
He says this is the only card he has.
Yeah, let me answer the card that every man wanted to write down, but some of you didn't have the guts to. It's what about masturbation?
That actually is this
that
question.
Is? Oh, hey, how about that?
Well, and it's verbatim.
Okay, what about masturbation?
If that's not the Holy Spirit moving, I don't know.
Okay, so here's the deal. I'm a Christian. I'm a counselor. Okay, so let me just kind of give you the whole package. There's no verse in the scripture that says masturbation is a sin. Okay? Now, with that said, the last thing that you need to do is to super glue your brain to pictures, because masturbation usually comes with pornography and lust. Last thing you need to do is super glue your brain in that direction. All right? That's not going to be productive for you. But the challenge for Christian men is oftentimes, oh, I can't believe I did that. I'm such a terrible Christian. I've prayed and asked God to help me stop, and he hasn't. Maybe he doesn't care for me. Maybe he's not there. Maybe I'm really bad. Hey, you're precious in God's eyes, and he has a plan for you and a plan for your sex life in the context of marriage. So masturbation is not necessarily the issue, and I'm not giving you license to go home and masturbate here, okay? Because you know from what I was telling about brain chemicals, that'll bond your brain toward pornography and lust and masturbation. And then you're going to get married, and here's this beautiful lady that God created for you, and what's that going to be like for your sex life, for your marriage? So you need to think down the road, what do I want? Don't beat yourself up on this area, guys, on the one hand. On the other hand, don't super glue your brain to something that's false and that's not going to be satisfying in the end. Does that make sense? You see the two sides of that issue? Okay. Hey, sometimes people say that everything's permissible, but not everything's beneficial. That's out of context. Okay. That's out of context here. That's in quotes in the Bible, and that was a phrase that was used back then. And you know, okay, so you all may say everything's, you know, permissible. That's out of context here. Hear my heart on don't super glue your brain to something and don't shortchange what you want in the future.
Did you want to read yours, or do you want me to do this one?
I was going
to
say, you had a really good one.
Oh, okay. If sex is only reserved for marriage, then what does one do with one's normal biological desires? How does one release without sinning? You don't. I guess what we were just saying, you don't. I mean, there's the only way to release that would be through, like, masturbation or premarital sex, unless there's something new that's come out that I don't know about. Listen, we've said it. The struggle is real. It's hard. But here's, in this... Having been someone who fell in multiple ways before I was a Christian, and even after I was a Christian sexually, there is nothing like sex within marriage. And when someone used to say, and this people used to say that when I was single, I was like, yeah, okay, whatever. Okay, you're a clown. I'm telling you as a man who's experienced it, it is a beautiful, precious, amazing gift from God. And if you could just wait and set aside those things, and I'm not saying it's easy, but life isn't easy. And it's the difficult things in my life and in your life that, you know what it does? It presses us into Jesus. That in our moments of weakness, when I can't do this, God, like whether it's anger, I don't know what your vice is, but those weaknesses, they press us into Christ. And we have choices to make in those moments when it's like, well, what do I do? Do I release or do I press into him? Or do I do an escape this way or this way? Choose Jesus and seek first his kingdom. Those things will be added. I know it's the waiting part's always the hard part. But the answer, I guess, simply is you don't release before marriage. You guys want to add anything to that or?
That was good.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
We got time for one more question. I'll read this, and we'll let you go. We got about 5 minutes before we get you out of here. What are some healthy boundaries that I should have with a girl who is just a friend as a church leader? I'll just go ahead and take the church leader out of that part. I mean, because the reality is, what are some healthy boundaries that you should have with a girl who is just a friend? Let me just make it as practical as I possibly could, and then I'll get biblical. If I walk this line too often, at some point, I'm bound to fall over and fall into your lap. That's just the reality. My balance is not, see, I'm almost going to do it right now. See, I was going to demonstrate the most real illustration you've ever seen. At some point, you are bound to fall. If you continue to tiptoe around the edges, don't put yourself in precarious situations where you're gonna be tempted. And the reality is she could be a girl who's just a friend or a church leader, but she's a girl. And we are designed as men to like girls. They're attractive, especially if it's my wife. She's bad. And the struggle was real when I was dating her. I'm not gonna lie. James 1 talks about temptation and turning into sin, and then sin full blown turns into death. It's this process, right? This process of being tempted. Boundaries. Just don't put yourself in the position to be tempted, because eventually temptation will turn into sin because you're walking this fine line. Pastor Steve Williams, my spiritual father, who's now in North Carolina, once said these words: keep it in the middle and on top. Keep it in the middle and on top. And he's talking about that fine road, that narrow road. Just stay in the middle and on top, because the more and more you try to, well, I wonder what that looks like. I can kind of. Where am I at now? With a church leader, friend. So try your best to keep it in the middle and on top as much as depends on you. Don't put yourself in a position. Don't think that you can overcome. I'm strong. I can overcome. No. Don't stick around to find that out. Keep it in the middle and on top. Does that make sense?
Let me add just a little bit to that also. Another way you can think about it is, hey, I'm married. Been married 23 years. And Shannon is, she's drop-dead gorgeous. If she came around the corner and saw me doing something with another woman right now, kissing her, sitting on her lap, hugging her, would she have a problem with that? Yeah. Okay. Well, your wife would too. All right. The morning I got married, if I was kissing another woman or sitting her on my lap and hugging her, would my wife let me put a ring on her finger? No way. Okay. How about, like, I'm going to ask her to marry me. Let's back up the clock a little bit more. I'm going to ask her to marry me. If she saw me doing that at the airport when she came to pick me up to come back and, you know, propose to her, you think she'd say yes? No. Faithfulness to my wife, she expects it today. She expected it the day before we got married. And she expected it before we got engaged. That's one of the things that attracted her to me. Don't do anything with a girl now that you wouldn't do with your wife standing there watching. Okay? Because that girl might not be your wife. And you're super gluing your brain to her. That make sense? Cool.
All right, well, that concludes our time here. We are going to head back to the sanctuary. But before we do that, let me pray for us. And then we'll head back. Father, we come before you and thank you for everything that was said. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would work in the hearts of every man in this room, us with the microphones and everybody in that's listening, God. We're men, we understand the struggle is real. But God, we realize what you've done for us is real. I pray that we would walk in the power of your resurrection, Lord, that we would walk in the intimacy that you give, God, that we can have with you. Jesus, I pray for every man in this room that, God, we would war, we would fight, but know that you've already won and walk in with, and walk in that, God. I pray that, Holy Spirit, you would empower each and every one of us to walk in that life, that we'd reckon ourselves dead to sin but alive with you. I pray if there's anybody in here that is dealing with shame or condemnation, Jesus, that you would release them of that, that they would recognize that there for is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for those who walk according to the Spirit. So Father, empower us, I pray, as we go out. Help us to be men who fight, who are strong, and that rely on you for everything that we do. Bless the rest of this night, I pray, in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
Amen. Amen.